Thank you, Lord.
Appreciate you.
Amen.
Love you.
We love you too. Amen. The Lord is good, isn't he? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Father, we're just so grateful and thankful. Lord, we're so grateful and thankful for your presence, for your glory that's here this morning. Thank you, Lord. We're so honored to be with you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence. And we reverently wait in your presence, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We magnify you. And we glorify you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Bless the Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. We just reverently wait in your presence. Thank you, Lord, for your glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we magnify you. We glorify you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask Jonathan to come. He's going to share for just a moment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
It's good to be in the presence of the Lord. I know in Isaiah it says, those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. And, you know, sometimes in the world and in doing things for God, sometimes we tend to use some of our strength up. But God doesn't want us to use up all of our strength. But when we lose our strength, then we can't do what God wants us to do to the fullest. So when we come and we worship the Lord and we spend time with Him, He enables us to do what He's called us to do. And that's why it's so important that we don't just spend time with the Lord when we meet together, but when we're on our bed by ourselves. When it's, you know, just a beautiful night sky and you're just saying, Lord, I love you. I remember when I was 12 years old, I moved from Canada down to the United States. And, you know, there's just a few things running through my mind. And I had a little MP3 player about that big. And I had Christian music on it. And as I would sit there on my bed, I would turn my MP3 player on and just listen to worship songs. And, you know, just a 12-year-old kid, you know, not really trying to be real spiritual or anything, but as I would worship the Lord with the music, the presence of God would just come into my room.
Amen.
And He would strengthen me and He would help me. Mm-hmm. And God, He wants to help us. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want us to lose our strength. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to my dad.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, what's interesting is during praise and worship, I grabbed my Bible and scratch down the very scripture Jonathan just referred to. Amen. Hallelujah. Because I believe there's some things that God wants us to get today for all of us. And I want you to write some of these things down and don't ever forget them. All right? Go with me to Isaiah 28, first of all. Isaiah 28. Thank you, Lord. The presence of the Lord is in here today. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you, Lord. When back in 1980, our family moved from northern Michigan down to Oklahoma. I was just a young kid at that time, and our family owns and operates a hunting and fishing resort there in Michigan. And my dad felt the call to go to Bible school and eventually into the ministry. And so here we loaded everything up and packed up and moved from Michigan to Oklahoma. Well, it was a couple of days' drive, and we got there to Tulsa one evening, and we stayed in the home of some friends that we knew from Michigan. And so, you know, my brother, my sister, and I were in the living room just playing. TV was on. But, you know, my mom and dad and this other couple, they were at the dining room table talking about ministry and talking, because they were going to go to Bible school as well. But their son was grown, and he was a pastor down in Texas. Now, here we are playing and everything, and I always thought I'd have made a really good spy. Not because I'm American, but I just, I'm aware of stuff going on around me. I don't always let on, but I could be holding a conversation with one person, and I know what people are talking about all around me. Just always had that ability, that knack. It comes in handy as a pastor. And so, but I'm listening to the adults while we're all playing there, and TV's roaring, and they were talking about their son and how he had burned out in the ministry. And now, I don't mean that I was just super, super spiritual. I'm just a kid, you know. And that term burnout just was like a neon sign to me. It was just something that God, even as a little kid, put in my heart, that burnout is bad.
Right.
It's a bad thing. And I, in the course of years, I came across a lot of ministers, people that they burned out, whether it was in the ministry or serving God or in business. And I just begin to see how terrible a thing that being burned out was. You know, there's people that you know, they'll even joke about burning out. I'd rather burn out, you know, than, you know, whatever. We don't have to do any of that.
That's right.
Amen. And I'm so thankful. Now, I'm not the smartest person in the world. You know that. Amen. Now, I'm not criticizing myself, but there's some things that I just learned from experience. Some things that God was just so merciful to me that He showed me these things early on that I never had to make the mistakes of other people. You know, if it's icy out here some winter evening and somebody walks out the door and slips on the ice, all right, I don't have to follow their example and slip on the ice.
Right.
I can learn from their mistake. And so there's things that I learned from just watching people, things that I learned because the Holy Ghost you know, showed it to me, or things that I just banged my head against the wall until I was senseless and finally eventually stumbled upon it and figured it out. But I can say this, that in about 24 or so years of being in the ministry, I have never, ever gotten weary or burned out, weakened, discouraged, disgusted, or any of those things. Never, never once. Now that doesn't mean that I'm just floating through life and hear the angel choir, you know, every day. No, I pass up marvelous opportunities to give up and to quit and to be discouraged daily. Amen. I just don't take them.
That's right.
But I learned I learned how to be strong. And this is where I want you to write these things down, because it'll help you and it'll help other people that are around you. Amen. So in Isaiah 28, look at what it says here in verse 11. Now, I want you to realize this is the word of God. This isn't my word. I just happened to stumble upon it and found out that it works, and it'll work for you. Verse 11, Isaiah 28:11, with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. How many of you know he's talking about tongue talkers?
Yeah.
Speaking in tongues. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. Mm-hmm. Amen. Mm-hmm. Now, let's look over at Isaiah 40. Now, I'm going to make a statement that it just might curl your hair today. All right, Isaiah 40. It just might upset your little boat. Amen. Praise the Lord. But sometimes we, how many of you know we need our little boat upset?
Yeah.
Isaiah chapter 40. I don't try to be controversial. I don't try to be confrontational. There's one lady that when she said it, then I begin to recognize it. When the anointing comes real strong on me, I get ornery. And she said, Brother Greg, you are sure ornery. And she's a little embarrassed about that now, but I'll joke with her whenever I'm there in her town. But I don't try to be that way. But sometimes that anointing, it just pierces right through callousness. And see, there's a lot of people that, now just everybody smile and look forward, and nobody will know we're talking about you. But there's some people that they are so crusty that they need a good sledgehammer blow to knock that crust off, to get down to the good solid meat. Well, there's a friend of mine, he's a traveling minister as well, and when he was growing up, his stepdad, I believe it was stepdad, would refurbish and redo knives and metal and steel and stuff out there in the garage. And so my friend brought him an old, rusty, corroded blade, all right? And so he gave it to his dad, and he put it on the anvil, and the first tool he grabbed was the hammer. Like, you know, he's wanting to renew it, make it beautiful again, sharp again. But the first tool he grabbed was the hammer. And he put it there on the anvil and just gave it a good whack. And all that crustiness and flakes of corrosion just went flying. Amen. Until he had something solid that he could work with and to begin to renew. And sometimes I think preaching and teaching is just like that. Not that we try to give people a sledgehammer blow. I mean, you know, Brother Ron here, he's evidence of that. Just look at his lip. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now we got something we can work with there. Amen. Right. We'll line the rest of you up back behind the barn here after church. Amen. But notice here, this verse 31, but they that wait upon the Lord. Now that doesn't mean sitting in the corner and just passing the time by. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. What does it mean to wait upon the Lord? It literally means to be braided with and intertwined with the Lord. How do you do that? Through praying in the Spirit, worshiping God, and spending time with Him. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Now, I'm going to make this statement. Now, don't hate me for it, but just swallow the horse pill. All right? Because it's good for you. It'll help you. If you show me a person that's weary, tired, burned out, ready to give up, then I will show you a person that doesn't wait upon the Lord. Now, how do I know that? Because I've been there. That's how I learned some of these things. How many know that as a minister, as a pastor, you don't always have it easy? Just think of all the different kinds of people that the pastor has to deal with. People just like you and me. That's not easy all the time. Here's somebody bless their darling heart and really stupid head. They'd say to a minister like me or somebody else, "Well, you only have to work an hour on Sunday." That's the dumbest thing. You might as well not even get out of bed in the morning. Amen. Because being a pastor is one of the most difficult, challenging jobs on the planet. Amen. Like I'm from the States, we have a president there. To be voted in as president of the United States, you'd have to take a demotion if you were a minister to do that. You're busy all the time, especially as you begin to grow and as you develop in the church and whatnot. You're constantly dealing with people. You're constantly dealing with problems. Sometimes 3 o'clock in the morning, here's some woman screaming, "Come cast the devil out of my kid." All right, stuff like that happens all the time. And so I found that as a young pastor, I began when I was 23 years old. And then that summer turned 24. Not much older than Jonathan. I mean, I didn't know nothing, as we see down in Oklahoma. I didn't know Khmer from Sikkim. So I would go to the mail at the post office. We had to pick it up. And my stomach would turn in knots because, what bill is there today? The phone would ring. And I mean, it would just be like panic would just come over me because here's somebody. What problem do they have? And what's going to happen now? Somebody's upset. Somebody's mad. What fire do you got to put out? And, here could be the deacon and the elder in a fist fight out in front of the church. Amen. Or, here's some member with the praise and worship leader wants to fight him out in front of the church. And so I recognized early on that was the devil just trying to steal from me, trying to put me into some kind of a bondage. And so I said, this stops right now in the name of Jesus. When I go to the mail, I'm looking for blessing. When the phone rings, I'm looking for an opportunity for the anointing of God that's on the inside of me to rise up and begin to speak out by the inspiration of the Holy Ghost to meet whatever need that's there. And I changed my perspective. But the main thing that made the big difference in my life was I became a person of prayer and a person of ministering to the Lord. Amen. And when you minister to the Lord and you come into His presence, then the Bible says He inhabits the praise of His people. I learned how to come into the presence of God. And by doing so, then His strength is infused into me. Everything that He is, then I become as I'm spending time with Him. And so all the strength that He has becomes part and parcel of what's operating through me by spending time with Him and by waiting upon the Lord. Now, it says you'll renew your strength. It's the best vacation in the world. It's the most refreshing when you pray in the Spirit. It does not benefit directly your flesh, but number one, it does something to your spirit. Go with me, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians 14. And I want to draw your attention to verse 2. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. When you pray in the Spirit, when you pray in tongues, you're talking to God in His language. people might say, "Well, do I have to pray in tongues? Do I have to speak in tongues to be filled with the Holy Ghost?" You get to. You don't have to. You get to. Amen. It's completely a supernatural thing. You don't learn to speak in tongues. It's the evidence that you're filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. And it says here, "For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. But he that prophesieth speaketh unto men to edification, exhortation, and comfort." He that speaketh... Now notice carefully verse 4. "He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself." What does that mean, to edify? Now, I'm assuming, I did look one time, peek in the barn, I think it was last year when I was here, and I'm assuming there's a tractor around somewhere. Is that right? Now, the tractor, does it have one of those great big batteries like, you know, my in-laws do? Great big battery?
Two of them.
Two of them. Have you ever had to hook the charger up to it?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. What does that charger do to the battery? It
boosts the battery.
It boosts the battery. Now, when you hook that charger up, does it happen instantly?
Mm-hmm.
Not usually. But as you keep it hooked up, for how long would you say you've had to keep it plugged in?
Oh, well, even an hour.
An hour? Have you ever done it maybe even for a couple hours, overnight perhaps?
Yeah.
Well, when it says here that he that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself, it's the same as when Brother Ron hooks the charger up to the battery on the tractor. That's what that word edify means. It literally means to charge. How many of you know, like Jonathan brought out, that things in the world will tend to drain you. You've got responsibilities, you've got deadlines, you've got people demanding things of you. Amen. And there are things that will just naturally pull you down. All right? That's why it's so exciting to see so many of you here on a Saturday morning.
Yeah.
I mean, of all the things that you could have done, you could have stayed at home and watched cartoons,
yeah,
for all that matters. But you decided to come out here. When you speak in tongues, it edifies your spirit.
Amen.
Amen? It will charge you. It will build you up spiritually. Now, when you get charged up spiritually on the inside of you, it will eventually affect the outside of you. Amen? Now, I learned a lesson a number of years ago when I was going to Bible school. You know, had my own apartment, working a job, working my way through school. And my dad phoned me up one morning, one day. And I answered the phone. I said, "Hello." He barked at me. He said, "You haven't been praying the Holy Ghost, have you?" I'm like, "What?" I'm spinning, you know. Here he just barked at me. "What in the world are you talking about?" I said, "How did you know?" He said, "I could tell just by the way you said hello that you are down, you're worn, you're frazzled, you haven't been praying the Holy Ghost." Amen. Man, I took my cue. I mean, just by the way that I said hello, he could tell. See, he knew me. Amen. Because he that speaks in an unknown tongue edifies himself. See, there was a minister, actually I'll just tell you, it was Keith Moore said this. He was one of my instructors at Rhema, and it doesn't mean that I know him personally, and, you know, I'm buds with him, but I have sat down with him and whatnot. But he said this one time. He had gone to a church to preach, and there was a lady across the altar area, the front, on the front row, but just across from him. And his attention kept getting drawn to her. And, you know, I mean, she just looked terrible. She looked like a mess. I mean, she looked like somebody run over her dog just right before church. And, I mean, she just looked sad and just, his attention just kept being drawn to her. So finally, during praise and worship, he leans over to the pastor and says, "Who is that over there?" And he said, "Oh, that's one of our intercessors. They're always under a deep burden of prayer." And without him thinking, he said, "Well, that's one person I'd rather not pray for me."
Yeah.
Amen? Because spiritual strength is always manifested in joy. Amen?
Amen.
Always. You show me a strong person, and I'll show you one that's full of joy too. Amen? And see, when you and I pray in the Spirit, we are building ourselves up. One person, bless their darling heart, they said, "Well, that's just selfishness to want to build yourself up." No, it's Bible sense.
Yes.
Amen. I don't want to call it common sense because common sense isn't so common anymore. But it is Bible sense. God does not want us barely dragging by our spiritual gauge, running on empty until we finally get to a special meeting, get to church or something like that, where we just, you know, fill up a little bit to make it to the next stop. Mm-hmm. No, He wants us built up, strengthened all the time. Be ready, instant, in season, out of season, for His plan and for His purpose. There is no reason to ever get down.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Amen. Well, it's Monday, you know, we're supposed to be blue. It's Wednesday, we finally made it over the hump, and thank God it's finally Friday. Amen. Bless God, you can get out of bed on Monday morning just as refreshed and just as ready as any time. Amen. And we don't always need crutches to pick us up. What do I mean by that? See, in the world, they're always looking for a buzz. Mm-hmm. Always looking for a buzz, because there's nothing on the inside of them that lifts them up. So they're always turning to comedy, jokes, always looking for something to give them that next little boost or that next little buzz. And then some people even turn to chemicals and drugs and stuff that they drink and put in their bodies to give them that little bit of a boost. Now, I might step on some people's toes here with this. There's some people that even turn to fad diets. I'm not against, you know, watching what you eat and diets and stuff like that. But there's some people that they look to those type of things to always give them their boost. The Bible says right here that the Holy Ghost will do the same thing for you.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, I'll leave that one alone. I could meddle there, but the Bible says, maybe I will meddle a little bit. The Bible says, let your moderation be known unto all men. You know, there's people that, you ought not to drink that. That's poison. You ought not to eat that. Man, that'll kill you. You know what I said one time? Then I said, well, then I'll die with a smile on my face. You'll know that I was happy. Amen. Well, I haven't died yet. Praise the Lord. Not going to die. Not planning on it. I'm going to finish the full course of the ministry. Going to help people. Yeah. And be able to see, we get off a lot of times on just different kicks. Amen. The best thing to do is just stay right down the middle of the road and put the Word of God into practice, and it'll work for us.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. Now, that doesn't mean we ought to be foolish. You know, if somebody offers you, now I like pecan pie, all right? But that doesn't mean I sit down and eat the whole pie. Amen. There's nothing wrong with having a piece of it. We were somewhere and had some genuine Saskatchewan Saskatoon pie. Amen. And it was good. I mean, it was really good. Actually, now, I've always liked blueberry pie, you know, like living in Alberta, we had more blueberries. The Saskatoons there were more woody tasting, smaller, but man, this was even better than blueberry pie.
Moose Jaw's better.
Amen.
Yeah.
Was it here that I had the Saskatoon? Oh, it was with you. See, we go so many places, I forget, and it all kind of gets mixed up. But it was with Ron and Lorna, we had that Saskatoon pie. Man, it was good. Amen. I lost track after that pie.
Yeah.
Amen. That was on that Friday that we stayed here. That's right. So, but you wouldn't sit down and eat the whole pie. Then there'd probably be a problem. The Bible says, if you're given to an appetite, put a knife to your throat. Amen. If your eye offend, they pluck it out. If something is causing you trouble, then just don't mess with it. Plain and simple. Amen. Well, but I better not say that. I better not meddle anymore. Amen. Praise the Lord. But it is all good, isn't it? It'll all help us. See, if we get off in natural things, it's really easy to get off in spiritual things too. Think about that. If we get into a tangent in natural things, it's real easy to get off on tangents even in spiritual things. Amen. The best thing is to stay right down the middle of the road and walk in the light that we have. And God will bless us for it. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself. Now go with me to the book of Jude, if you would. The book of Jude. Right before Revelation. Book of Jude. Are you getting anything at all today?
Yeah.
Amen. Good. I'm having a good time. I don't know about you, but I'm having a good time. Verse 20. Jude, verse 20. But ye beloved, building up yourselves What does that say? Building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Amen? Praying in tongues, praying in the Spirit, praying in the Holy Ghost is all the same thing. It's going to edify you. It's going to build you up. It's going to stimulate your faith. Amen? One of the greatest things that you can do is praying in the Spirit. Now, go back with me real quick to 1 Corinthians 14. I want us to look at a different side of the coin. 1 Corinthians 14, once again. I should have had you just keep your finger there. Now, verse 14. It says, "For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful." When you pray in the Spirit, it is a direct activity of your spirit. That's who you are. You are not the person that you look at in the mirror. The Bible teaches that you are a spirit. You have a soul, which is your mind, your intellect, your emotions, your reasoning faculties, and you live in a body. This body is the house you live in. The body is not who you are. Amen? In 1 Corinthians, I believe it's 9:27, the Apostle Paul said, "I keep under my body, I bring it into subjection. Lest that by any means, when I preach to others, I myself should be a castaway." He called his body it. He didn't say, "I keep myself under." He said, "I keep my body under. I bring it into subjection." His body had desires and appetites that were separate and distinct from himself, which is spirit. See, the Bible says that God is a spirit. You and I were created in the image and likeness of God. If God is a spirit and you were created in his image and likeness, of necessity, you are a spirit being. Amen. Amen. And your spirit has the same characteristics and the same attributes as what God does. Now, on the way up here today, the horses were in the little corral there. Now, I'm a horse person. Okay, now I don't look like it this morning, but I'm a cowboy. I know how to do all the cowboy stuff, done all the cowboy stuff, separated cows and wrangled calves and all that kind of stuff, cut and band and everything. Do it all and do it from horseback. Love horses and Karen's even more so. All right, I mean if I love horses and I do horse stuff, Karen is like Arnold Schwarzenegger on horse stuff. I mean, she is the alpha mare when she goes into the pasture. All right. Now it's real funny. Where am I going with this, Lord? But I'll go into the pasture and I'll say, "Maverick," that's my horse, and he'll just come running up to me from wherever. I could be gone a month, and he'll come run up and he'll just put his head right on my chest, and I'll just love on him, and then Karen will go out there into the pasture, and it's like all the ears come alert, the hair raises up on the back of their neck, and I mean it is totally different. All right, and they go into a completely different mode when she's out there because she's the boss. I mean, I'll love on them, and I'll just, I'm their friend, and well, maybe I've learned better than that, but I'm a lot softer than what she is. But she gets out there, and it's business time when she's there. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Now, Lord, help me to get back on track. I got a little too far off that rabbit trail. Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Spirit. You see, you are a spirit. And when you pray in tongues, it is an exercise of your spirit. It's not a mental thing. You don't think in advance of the words in tongues that you're going to speak. You're allowing your spirit to speak through your mouth in the language of God. The Holy Ghost, who resides on the inside of you, he's given you the words to speak. Amen. Amen. And as you do so, you are charging and building yourself up. But you are a spirit. You have a soul. You live in a body. The body is your earth suit. Just like in outer space, for an astronaut to have expression out of the space capsule, they've got to have a space suit. And so your body gives you expression on this earth. It gives you authority on this earth. But the real you is spirit. Now see, if somebody were to die, their body is placed in the grave. And if you've ever been to a funeral and you've seen that body lying there, now we're not trying to be disrespectful, understand, but there's nobody there. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Mm-hmm. So that body that's there in the casket or at the funeral, that was the house that they lived in. Amen. Now let me just throw something else out there for you. Now if, we'll just say Jonathan here, all right? If he were to come to me and say, Dad, I took a position over in, you know, another province or another state, and they're providing me a house with this job, $670,000 house. All my bills are paid, and I'll have more money than I've ever seen in my entire life. I'm going to have every convenience and every benefit, every blessing that I've ever dreamed of. It's all there, and I'm moving. Well, I don't go, oh, Jonathan, I'm so sad that you've taken such a blessing. What do? I'm not, glory to God, woo! He's been promoted. When somebody moves to heaven, that's all that they're doing. Yeah, right. Man, wait till you see my house. Amen. I've seen it, to be honest. I've actually seen it. The Lord allowed me to see it one time. We're not going to get into that. But man, wait till you see it. Amen. I'll invite you all over for coffee. We'll have Tim Hortons. Amen. Come on over to my place. Amen. You bring the Timbits and I'll provide the coffee. Amen. At Jonathan's place. They'll have that. But see, to be absent from the body, see, when a person dies, their spirit, if they're saved, immediately goes to Jesus. They don't go wandering around. They don't go the scenic tour and look at the mountains. No, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That's the spirit that has gone. All right? And their body is buried 6 feet under. But then one day, very soon, there's going to be a trumpet sound blast so loud, going to blow grandma right out of the grave. Amen. And your loved ones, my mother that died several years ago, going to blow her right out of the grave. So a brand new body. We're not talking about some horror movie where these grotesque things start coming up out of the ground. We're talking about glory.
Yeah.
A glorified body that they'll be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And they'll have a brand new body. They'll have a body that's adapted to heaven. Thank God we're going to have a brand new body when we get to heaven. You can have a healed one and a whole one down here, but when we get to heaven, it's going to be a glorified body.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. But that's your spirit. I wanted to point that out, that it's your spirit. When you're praying in the Holy Ghost, that's being built up. See, one reason why we have such of the difficulties is our spirits are puny, out of shape, not developed. You can develop spiritually just like you can develop mentally and physically. Now, don't throw that out just because that's a solid piece of meat. Chew on that for a little bit. You can develop your spirit just like you can go to the gym and develop your muscles. Amen. You can develop your spirit just like you go into college and develop in your brain and educate yourself. You can be developed spiritually. But there's not a single chair in any university for the development of the spirit.
Amen.
There's not a single facility in any town that I'm aware of that will have exercise equipment for your spirit. But they do for your body, they do for your mind, but not for the spirit. And the spirit is the real you.
Amen.
If you ever hear people try to quote that scripture, they'll almost always get it out of whack. The Bible says, I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body. They'll usually say it backwards, body, soul, and spirit. Mm. Have you ever noticed that? Mm-hmm. Why is that? Because they're more body conscious than they are spirit conscious. The spirit is not real to them. But the body is real. And a little bit of the mind, and you know, which is your soul, your intellect, your emotions, and so on. But the spirit's just unfamiliar territory. And it's a shame, because that's the real you. God is a spirit. And they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. But see, so many times in the church world, they're turning the worship experience into a soul and a flesh experience. Now, how do we know that? Because they got to have the smoke and lights to make it exciting and attractive. They got to get the music and the volume to a fever pitch. They got to have the light show just right. They got to have the smoke machine to imitate the glory of God. And it becomes a worldly concert atmosphere rather than a spiritual experience.
Wow.
Yeah. Amen. The Bible says in Chronicles that the glory of the Lord appeared in the temple. A cloud filled the temple to the point where the priests could not even stand and minister by reason of the cloud. Amen. That was not a smudge because they had bad mosquitoes that day. That was not them, the burning of incense in the temple. It was the glory of God that come in. Just like last night, there was a haze that almost like a smoke that filled the whole place here last night. Amen. But see, we are spirit beings. And if we will learn to put the real us first in the Word of God and experience by praying. See, when you pray in the Spirit and you're talking in tongues, that is your spirit. That is a spiritual exercise that will help to develop you, strengthen you spiritually. The vast majority of our praying should be in the Spirit.
Amen.
Because you're a spirit being. Amen. Now, it's not wrong to pray in English, obviously. There's things that we need to address in prayer, things that we know about. But how many of you know there's things that you and I have no clue how to pray for? But the Bible says the Holy Ghost will take hold together with us in those times where we are unknowledgeable, and He will pray through us in the Spirit, and we can address things, mysteries of God even. Now, let's keep reading here for just a moment. Verse 17. Verse 15, rather. What is it then? I will pray in the Spirit, or with the Spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. So I will pray in tongues, and I will pray with my understanding. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also. That's part of waiting on God. Praying, singing in the Spirit, ministering to the Lord. Amen. Verse 17, for thou verily givest thanks well, but the other is not edified. Now, if I were to get up here and preach my message in tongues, it wouldn't do you a bit of good. It would do me good, because I'd be building myself up, edifying myself, but it wouldn't do you any good. Do you understand? Do you follow what he's saying there? It would do me good, because I'm edifying my spirit, but you wouldn't understand a word that I was saying. Unless I gave the interpretation or prophesied. That's why we don't, you know, in a public assembly, we don't just do everything in tongues. Because there's a place where you need to be edified by the Word of God through prophecy and preaching and teaching of the Word. But notice here, verse 18, I thank my God I speak with tongues more than you all. So just so we don't misunderstand the importance and the validity of praying the Spirit, he says, I pray in tongues more than anybody. More than this whole church even. He said, I pray in tongues more. So he put a premium on praying in the Spirit. There was a pastor friend of mine that... now see, I know exactly what he's talking about, because I had been there as well many times. He told me personally, he said, Brother Greg, I've taken my church as far as I know how to go. As far as I know, I've gone as far as I know how to go. And so he retired. And not long after that, he was dead. And he had come to one of our services, a prayer meeting actually, and comes to me and says, "Pastor Greg, you sure believe in praying in tongues, don't you?" I said, "I sure do. I did probably 95% of my praying in that prayer meeting, even praying in other tongues." He said to me, "You know, I'll pray for a few minutes," and realize he's a pastor of a congregation of several hundreds of people. Big time pastor, big church and everything. And he said, "I'll pray for a few minutes, you know, for the church and for people that I think of. And you know, maybe 30 minutes might even go by. And then I'll pray in tongues for 3 or 4 or 5 minutes maybe. And then I'm done." And here we spent the better part of an hour just praying in tongues alone. Well, when he said, "I've gone as far as I know how to go," I knew what he was talking about. Because several times, even in my life in ministry, it seemed like I come up to a point where, man, I've given everything that I've got. I've shared, I've taught everything that I know how to teach and share. There's nothing left. And I felt like I come right up to that boundary and just kind of hit a brick wall. But you know what I did? I prayed through the brick wall. I just got alone with God. I got into that private place of prayer. You don't take anybody with you. And just like that old eagle will get up to a high perch in a high place all by itself, and it'll pluck out those old worn out feathers. And it'll beat off that old worn out beak, and it'll grow new feathers and a new beak, and it'll become so renewed that I mean, it's just like a brand new eagle. And so I came to that place where, man, I didn't know how to go any further. But God led me to pray through that boundary and get over onto the other side, and then, man, you're sailing again. But it takes labor, it takes effort, it takes getting alone with God, it takes waiting upon the Lord. See, there's times in all of our lives, not just as ministers, but you reach a place where, man, I've given everything that I've got. I don't have anything left to give. But you get alone with God, and you get in that private place of waiting upon Him, and He will cause you to be like the eagle, to renew and to refresh and to start soaring all over again. Amen. Praise the Lord. You don't have to pop a pill to get that.
Yeah.
You don't have to pay a guru thousands and thousands of dollars to talk you through it. You can have it right here from the Word of God and be refreshed and be renewed before you walk out that door. Amen. See, the more I start talking and the more I speak along this line, man, it just builds me up even more. Praise the Lord. Where it feels like, you know, I could just go and invade hell with a squirt gun and set them free. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Are you getting anything at all?
Yep.
Now, we're going to close with one last scripture. Psalm 26. Are you glad you came this morning?
Yep.
Psalm 26. See, the Lord knows what we need. Write down every scripture. Don't let it get away from you. Verse 2. Now, if you're a horse person, you're going to understand this. And if you're not a horse person, well, then we'll help you understand it. Verse 2, Psalm 26, 2, "Examine me, O Lord, and prove me, try my reins and my heart." You know, I travel a lot, and sometimes I don't get to see Maverick as much as I'd like to. Don't get to ride him as much as I'd like to. And sometimes I've gone over a month and not even touched him. And, you know, I'll saddle him up and work with him a little bit and get him, you know, in a mindset to work and to ride and you know, to be with me. And he's always a willing partner. And we just have a tremendous time. But if I haven't ridden him a long time, I've got to do more direct reining with him to get him to turn and to go through his maneuvers and go around trees and stumps and creeks and all that kind of stuff. And so... I've got to use a little extra pressure to direct rain in. All right? But if I've been working with him for a while, if I've been riding him for several days in a row, I can hold those reins, and I mean the slightest flick of my finger, and he will just go that way. That's just how he is. If I haven't worked with him for a long time, I've got to use a little more direct rein pressure to get him to go this way. And, you know, sometimes people, why doesn't God speak to me? And the whole time, he's yanking the reins, trying to get their attention. I just don't know why God didn't speak to me. Amen? He does speak to us through the Word of God. Did you realize today God's speaking to you? He is showing you how to be sensitive to Him, showing you how to walk in a place where you're always in strength and renewal and revival and fresh all the time. He's speaking that to you. Amen? So don't go out the door and Him have to keep yanking the reins trying to get our attention. Let's realize and become more sensitive that He's trying to deposit something on the inside of us. Amen? Now, I'm going to show you one last scripture. I said that was the last scripture, but I'd be cheating you if I didn't show you Psalm 32. Just go a couple pages over, and we'll close with this. Now, I was so excited about my rain scripture until one day I'm speaking in church, and my dad interrupted me. He can do that. He's my dad. Normally, I work alone. But he interrupted me and pointed the scripture out. And so I had to go back and ask him, where's that scripture again? Where's that scripture again? Just the other day, I had to say, where's that scripture again? Psalm 32:8. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way that thou shalt go. I will guide thee with my eye. You know, in the horse world, you have direct reining, which you pull to the right, and they'll go to the right. You pull to the left, they'll go to the left. Or you can neck rein. You got to teach them, you understand. And you just lean the reins over to the right, and they'll go that way. It's like power steering in a car. Lean the reins over this way, and they'll go that way. Well, now our horses are not perfect, you understand. But we don't even need reins. Okay, now normally we'll, put the head stalls on them and everything, but you can just, with your feet and with your knees and pressure in the seat, you can just, they'll go where you want them to go. All right? God wants us to become so sensitive to Him, He's not pulling on the reins anymore. He just looks a certain way and we're jumping, we're moving. That's where He wants to get us to. Amen? I remember years ago having the attitude, about falling under the power. I used to say this, that man, if I'm going to go into the power, God's going to have to knock me down. I used to say that. I didn't realize I was being dumb. I had a part to play. See, I was so stiff and so resistant that's how I was talking. Didn't realize God's trying to yank my reins and didn't even know it. My mouth was so callous to those reins. But I'm endeavoring that He doesn't have to do that anymore. That if God just looks a certain way, like this thing with the airplane. You know, somebody might say, well, did God say, thus saith the Lord, Greg, I want you to buy an air? No, He didn't say that. But it's like I saw Him look that way, and so I'm moving that way. Amen. See, I'm not waiting for some tug on the rein. I'm not waiting for some sign or, oh God, I'll do it if you give me a sign. No, the Bible says it's an evil and adulterous generation that seeks after a sign. I just see Him look that way and I start moving that way. I don't have to wait for three confirmations in a song. I don't have to, wait for the dew to be on the towel in the morning, then the dew on the grass the next time. I don't need a fleece. Right. All I need is for Him to look that way, and I'm moving. You might say, do you always get it perfect? No, but I would rather, miss it and be doing my best to follow God than just do nothing and sit still. It's a whole lot easier to move a car and steer a car that's moving than one that's parked and got the e-brake on. And that's where a lot of Christians are, is that they're just sitting there, oh, I'm waiting on God to do something, I'm waiting on God. And the whole time, I mean, he's flagging, he's waving, and we're sitting there in our car, and we've got the emergency brake on, and it's turned off, and the keys are probably buried in our pocket somewhere. Get moving, get doing something, and God has something to work with. Amen. Father, we just thank you for your word. Sambrande ke blebiske, chashkan jandele, kan soprandopre, Kishkedeva and Madabasokoya, Tambra Mashata Vatabasike, Ekadabasata. For I desire my people to be moving, alert, and awake. It is time to awaken unto all the things that belong unto thee. Time to realize that I'm for you, I'm not against you. I am working with you, you working with me, following my spirit, obeying the word, and the fruit thereof shall manifest and shall be surely seen and given unto you, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. For there is a time coming, yea, that is nigh upon thee, of an outpouring of my spirit, the like of which you have not seen before. An outpouring of my glory and of my spirit. And by natural means, it would wear you out. It would be difficult to keep up with what's happening. But you're not bound and limited by the natural, for thou art supernatural, spiritual. You must learn to renew your strength. You must learn to draw upon the life that is in Christ to be made manifest in your mortal flesh. So come and sit at my feet. Take up those things that are important unto me, and I'll cause you to run and not be weary, to walk and not faint, saith the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we're so grateful and we're so thankful. Thank you, Lord Jesus. How many of you are here today and you'd say, Brother Greg, man, that's me. I just need to be renewed and strengthened. I need to be boosted and picked up. We're going to give you a little bit of a jump start. Amen. Now, it's going to be up to you to keep your battery charged. But how many of you know that? See, in the car here, I don't, but in my truck at home, I got some booster cables. And those are in the case of an emergency. And there might be somebody here that you're just in an emergency. And now I can't take the place of you keeping your battery charged for you. I can't do that for you. But you know what? We got some booster cables, and we're just going to clip them on, and God will give you that head start. So if you're here this morning, and I never thought of it that way until just here this morning. That's just hot off the wire from the Holy Ghost. But if you're here this morning, and we'll minister to you. Amen. I believe God will refresh you. He'll supercharge you. But then now it's up to you to be a doer of the word after that. So I invite you to come down here to the front. We're going to minister to you. If that is you, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We just invite you to come. If there's anybody that's you, that you need that, just that extra oomph, so to speak. Hallelujah. Just come on down here. We're coming in faith to receive. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just praise you. Come ready to receive. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We are doers of the word. We've heard the word, and now we're going to do it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Just make your way down here. There's room for everybody that wants to come. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just magnify you. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We're in receive mode. We're shifting into receive gear. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want all of us to make a confession of faith this morning. Because you've all heard the word, but you got to commit to doing it.
Amen.
Well, how do you do it? Start praying in the Spirit more.
Amen.
Just spend some time. It doesn't mean you got to spend hours and hours and hours and hours. But just start spending more time.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And you'll notice immediate difference. So say this out loud. Heavenly Father,
I've heard your word.
I'm not just a hearer only, but I'm a doer of it.
I consecrate myself
and commit myself
to doing this word.
I will wait upon you.
I will pray.
I'll worship.
I'll
spend time with you.
And I will be renewed.
And strengthened.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. You know, I'll tell you what I saw in my spirit. I saw some women looking younger.
Huh?
Amen. I saw some people saying, What are you taking to look so young? What kind of cream or paste or what pill, what drug are you taking to look so young and fresh and beautiful? It's totally free. It's not cheap, but it's totally free. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Man, if I was a woman, I'd latch onto that. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We're going to lay hands on you in just a minute. We're just coming in the presence of God now. Lord, we thank you for the anointing. Father, I thank you for the angels that are here to help and to assist in this service. Do what you were sent and accomplish what you were sent to do in the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Jonathan, would you help? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. In the name of Jesus. There's the anointing. There's the anointing. Hallelujah. That'll just bless you and refresh you. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we release the anointing. Thank you, Lord. Now that anointing is not going to hurt you. It'll bless you and it'll help you. It'll strengthen you. We release. There's the anointing. We just allow that anointing to just flow in. In Jesus' name. In Jesus. We release the anointing. There it is. We release the anointing. There it is. Just allow that anointing to just flow right in. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We release the anointing. Thank you, Lord. Go ahead. We might need some folks to help Jonathan. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we release the anointing. Hallelujah. Lord, you're so good. Be refreshed. There's anointing. Be refreshed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Be refreshed. In the name of be refreshed. Receive it all in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. We just allow that to go into you. We allow that anointing to go all the way in. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we allow that anointing to just flow in. There it is. There it is. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If you could just bring them over this way. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we allow that anointing. There it is. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just are so grateful. In the name of Jesus, we allow the anointing of God to flow in from the top of her head, to be refreshed and renewed in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You know, it's not about a feeling, sister. It's about Him working on the inside of you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we magnify You. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Receive that anointing. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This is just such a sweet presence of the Lord here this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You ready to receive, sister? Amen. Then go ahead and receive all that He has for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. 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 Just get your mind on Jesus. Oh, He has so much for you. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, receive that anointing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, we magnify You and we glorify You, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Was there somebody else? We don't want to miss anybody. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. In the name of Jesus, we release that anointing. Thank you, Lord. We release that anointing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just be like a sponge and just soak it all in. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We just allow that anointing to just flow in. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. I can't help but keep thinking of butter. Now every time you email me, I'm going to think of butter. Wanda Butter. Hallelujah. Thank you. The Lord has a sense of humor. Thank you, Lord. He sits in the heavens and laughs. In the name of Jesus, we release the anointing of God to flow in to her from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. We allow that anointing. Will you do something for me, sister?
Yep.
Stop praying.
Yep.
Just turn your mind off even. You're in receive mode right now. Without struggle. Oh, there's the anointing. Thank you, Lord. We allow that anointing to just flow in. In total peace. There you go. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, the Lord is good, isn't He? Amen. I'm glad I came today. Sister, I notice you're wearing a brace on your back. Would you mind if I ministered to you?
Well, sure. I had great back surgery. My pain all went away with my back surgery. Just hold it in place till it's done healing.
Well, you know, the scripture talks about our health springing forth speedily. Well, God can speed up the healing process.
Okay.
Amen.
He's done a great job so far.
Sure.
I'll take some.
Come here, Miss Lauren. I'm going to have you to put your hand on her back. I'm going to put my hand on top of her hand.
How do I just take this off?
Well, that's up to you. I'm not asking you to do that, but hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
It gets too hot and uncomfortable. Anyway.
Yeah. So put your hand right on her back. Is that about where the surgery was?
Hmm?
Amen. In the name of Jesus. Father, thank you for guiding the surgeon's hands. But we pray now that her health would spring forth speedily. Father, reduce the healing time. We know that nature would take so long to do it, but with your power, it's sped up. So, Father, we release the anointing into her body that she will have complete, full range of movement and motion, that her healing will even astound her doctors. And they will know that it's by your hand that she's recovered so well. We give you the praise for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.